from all over the world. Well, I have to share my screen firstly. Do you see my screen?
You may do that. You have.
Πάτα κάνει share από κάτω. Πάτα το share από κάτω.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now you see my screen.
Yes.
Yeah? It's okay.
It's wonderful. Thank you.
I thank you. I have to thank you. Well, this presentation bears the title Cultural Landscapes and Heritage Conservation in Mountains, the case of Arcadia. You have already seen some images by Mrs. Constantinidou from Arcadia. Well, I have to say that I'm principally a designer, not an organizer. What I'm trying to do is to create narratives for the design of buildings, for the design of parks of urban space, of landscape formation. And recently, I'm trying to create narratives, to create ideas for the promotion of the identity of places. And well, our presentation refers to the importance of the preservation and promotion of the specific identity of the mountains area of Arcadia in Peloponnese Greece as an example of analogous possibilities and strategies that could be applied in a number of analogous cases in our country or in other countries with mountainous areas of similar characteristics. What do we exactly mean by the expression similar characteristics? We refer to mountainous territories with important natural landscape qualities in correlation, this is the most important, in correlation, however, to cultural historic importance, probably of international cross-border validity. Our principal presentation interest refers, as I already mentioned, to Arcadia, an important geographical reference for Western culture, at least for Western culture, and probably for the universal culture. Well, we shall begin, however, by commending the identity of a larger geographical area, that of Peloponnese. You can see the Peloponnese here, at the south part of the Hellenic Republic, by beginning with a reference to Peloponnese's cultural and political landscape. We shall refer to a first project of an analogous cultural identity promotion under the name Hercules in Argolida. Argolida is the place at the east part of Peloponnese here. And then we shall refer to a second one, our principal project of reference under the title Dr. Faust in the mountainous Arcadia. In reference to the expression preservation and promotion of the specific identity of a geographical area, of its natural and, of its cultural qualities, I have to comment the terms place branding and insist on the approach that I cannot work with place branding, that is to say, with place identity, as I do with common commercial identity. We cannot compare a pair of athletic shoes, for example, with a place of archaeological interest as Argos in Peloponnese. There is always a surplus value, a surplus political and cultural value in what we call place branding. Going on with our presentation, we shall thus insist on the historic fact that Peloponnese, Argolida, or Arcadia, for example, are cultural landscapes par excellence, and moreover, landscapes of political reference, some of the most important in the Western world. It is because of this that we try to introduce the notion of Herculean landscapes, landscapes of the ancient mythological hero Hercules, in order to characterize a network of places in Argolida and correlate them with other places in Europe. In the next image, we see the French Baroque gardens of Olivet-Combes and the statue of Hercules, an example of landscape reference to Hercules. I do not dare to use the terms landscape branding for Olivet-Combes. It's a cultural landscape example outside Greece that uses the reference to Hercules because of two different reasons. Firstly, Hercules may be considered as the metaphor of the incomparable strength muscular strength and political strength at the same time. Moreover, she was a landscape hero, a personification of the cultural strength that transformed wilderness into cultural controlled landscape. Here we see the portrait of Wilhelm III of the House of Orange, Nassau, stadtholder, governor of Holland, and afterwards King of England and Scotland, William III of England. And also we see his coat of arms with three oranges. Why three oranges? As reference to Hercules. Why? Because Hercules was used by William as an emblematic reference to his political strength and as a reference to the aesthetic interest of a Dutch garden crazy king. Garden crazy king, as William was described. In the next image, William III, as an ancient Greek hero, is arriving at the coast of England for his bourgeois-oriented glorious revolution in order to be enthroned as King of England. Hercules in Western history is the emblematic personality full of power that destroys evil and reforms landscape. Hercules, Aeolus, and Hydra of Lerna in an ancient presentation. Hercules with his companion Aeolus is killing the monstrous creature Hydra of the lake Lerna, a snake-like creature with many heads. Next image. Left, Gustave Moreau, Hydra. And right, John Sargent Singer, Hercules, 1921. The same representation was constantly repeated in Western history since Italian Renaissance. Here, we have a depiction of the 17th century of Henry IV of France presented as Hercules killing Hydra or his political enemies. Hydra is the metaphor for his political element. And here, we have an even earlier Renaissance painting by Antonio del Paraiuolo, Ercole and Hydra, Hercules and Hydra. Hercules is killing Hydra. That is to say, he controls the floods of the Arno River, not in Greece, but in Tuscany, near Florence. Why do we see such an intense interest for ancient Greek mythology, for ancient Greek history, and in association for the reference to the ancient Greek landscape by the post-Renaissance and neoteric Europeans, Westerners in general, and probably afterwards for an extended number of cultures outside Europe? The principal reason was not culture in the limited context of the pictorial arts, sculpture, or architecture. It had rather to do with political references. Ancient Greece and ancient Rome as well were considered as important examples of political strength, and after the 18th century, as the important paradigms of the democratic governance, as the initial paradigms for the formation of the neoteric democratic ethics, to which the Enlightenment, the formation of the neoteric political reason, would like to be oriented. In the next image, we may see Jacques-Louis David, Oath of the Oratii, a neoclassical emblematic reference to the political reason, to the political excellence of Rome, correlated to Enlightenment and the preparatory atmosphere of the French Revolution. We may also see a photograph of the landscape formation in Stowe. How we came back to landscape. In Buckinghamshire, England, with the small neoclassical foliage structure of the Temple of Ancient Virtue in an Arcadic landscape, as created in a metaphor of Arcadia, as created by William Kett between 1685 and 1748. Oh, we finally reached the term Arcadia. We comment again that bourgeois interest in classicism in general, in classical reference of landscape in particular, was highly correlated to political connotations, to connotations concerning ancient Rome and ancient Greek democracy. In the interior of the Temple of Ancient Virtue, we may find the statue of Epaminondas, general and politician from ancient Thebes, Lycurgus, politician from Sparta, Socrates and Homer. And now again, a photograph, pardon me, a photograph of the Temple of Ancient Virtue in the Arcadian environment of the Elysian fields of the Stowe Gardens. Well, Arcadia was considered by Western culture since Roman antiquity as the exemplary landscape of natural beauty and social freedom and happiness. Here we see the well-known painting by Nicolas Poussin, Et in Arcadia Ego, or Le Berger de l'Arcadie. Even in the ideal condition of Blessed Arcadia, death exists. That is the connotation of the title of the painting. And let us go back again to the beginning of the post-medieval formation of the Western culture. In Renaissance Florence, the famous governor of Florence, Lorenzo de' Medici, at the left, was described in Villa Medici in Fiesole near Florence as the Arcadic god Pan's kingdom. Villa Fiesole was the seat of the Academia Neoplatonica, of the first post-medieval important philosophical academy. Thus, the name Arcadia was correlated to natural excellence and to the cultural supremacy as well. Who was Pan? A mythological creature symbolizing the correlation of human existence with primordial naturalness. Pan or Panas had the hindquarters, legs, and horns of a goat. In the same matter as a satyr or faun. And his homeland was the rustic Arcadia. He was the god of the wild, shepherds and flocks, nature of mundane wilds, and rustic music. With his homeland in rustic Arcadia, he was also recognized as the god of fields, groves, wooded glens, and often affiliated with eroticism. Because of this, Pan was connected to fertility and to the season of spring. The reference to Pan, as the reference to Arcadia, transcends Western history. Here, a closer class depiction by John Reinhard Wekelin, The Magic of Pan's Flute, in early 20th century, and an earlier one of the Renaissance period from the Epinonotomachia Polyphony. In correlation to the development of culture and civilization, Arcadia was considered as the idealized prototype of the pastoral happiness. Here, we see this painting by Thomas Cole, the course of empire, the Arcadian or pastoral state, the state of the complete political and social happiness. And then we have a number of paintings that goes down. Destruction, finally the desolation. But at the beginning, there was the idealized image of Arcadia, of the complete landscape of freedom and happiness. And now back again to the lost Arcadian happiness by Thomas Aitkins, the end of 19th century, Arcadia. In the next image, we see Mephistopheles and Faust by William Harry Margetson and the depiction of Helen of Troy by Guido Reni. You probably know the story of Faust in the first volume of the homonymous narration by Johann Wolfgang von Goethe, the famous German romantic intellectual. Faust, in the first volume of the book, visits the devil, Mephistopheles, asking from the devil to help him having love adventures. In the second volume of the famous book, Faust is no more interested in body experiences. He is desperately looking for knowledge and asks Mephistopheles to help him reach the true value of beauty. Mephistopheles explains to him that he is only a German devil and that such a knowledge could only be found in the underworld of the ancient Greeks. Goethe was a German, he was not a Greek. Faust will visit the underworld and there he will ask from Helen of Troy to teach him the essence of beauty. Helen will explain to him that this knowledge could be achieved if Faust could visit the landscape of Greece. The didactics of Judith could be found in the landscape of Greece. They both travel from Thessaly down at the center of Greece to Peloponnese. Thessaly at the center of Greece. Faust and Helen of Troy travel down to Peloponnese. Dr. Faust finally arrives at Arcadia, at the land that the most beautiful is under the sun, a land that its presence offers to all other countries. Faust goes on speaking to Helen of Troy. There, our life happy will be and free, he explains. Thus, dear friends, our interest in Arcadia or in Argolida and in Peloponnese in general as a real geographical territory or as an idealized landscape reference is not a paradox. I think it does not only refer to a past mythological or historical entity. It rather refers to one of the constitutional formations of the European and Western civilization and of modern political imagery. Here we see the psychoanalytical metaphor of the Borromean knot, ne Borromien en français. According to the psychoanalyst Jacques Lacan, reality can never be achieved completely. It can never be reached in its full pragmatic value. It is always conceived through our imagery, our desires, or phobias. It is also conceived through the symbolic order, the symbolic. That is to say, through the syntactic formation of our cultural expression. It seems that for centuries, the social and political desires of the Western world were correlated to the ancient formal references, to classicism, and in association to it, to the reference to the ancient Greek landscape and to Arcadia. Arcadia as a symbolic order for the political visions, for our need, for our desire of freedom and happiness. Well, let's go on. Here we see a diploma thesis in the School of Architecture and TUA under the title Dwelling in Motion, Reviving the Railroadscape of Peloponnese. The railroadscape, not the railroad, not the landscape, the railroadscape. It refers to the effort of revival and promotion of the railroad of the mountainous central Peloponnese in correlation to a touring and didactic itinerary proposed par excellence for academic visitors. An image of this itinerary. The train. We can see the railroad line passing from the territory of the mountains Arcadia in the center of the map, and reaching Argolida at the eastern part. Wagons from the railroad will be transformed to teaching classrooms. We shall see them. While small cubicles may be used as rooms for the travelers. Here we see the rooms for the travelers. They are coming down from the railroad. Well, Peloponnesian railway, not only a way of transportation, but moreover, a way of living in motion. And kinesis, we say in Greek, in motion. And moreover, an academic educational device. Here we see the transformation of the railroad wagons to classrooms. Dedicated, well, an academic educational device dedicated to the history and the natural environment of Arcadia and Peloponnese. So we have academic didactics in motion. We could even extend our itinerary to nearby important nodal places of references. You see, as Olympia, Argos, Tripoli, you see, Mistras, a famous Byzantine place of reference. Olympia, the second place, where the ancient Olympic Games were always held. We may present in comparison an analogous example of a railroad line in a mountainous area, that of the Rhetische Bahn. A Ruritanian railway in the Eastern Alps region, accepted as a UNESCO Monument of Cultural Heritage. A railway passing from the territories of high touristic interest as St. Moritz or Lugano, and also correlated to a specific ethnic group considered as the oldest cultural nucleus of the Swiss population, the Raetian ethnic group. So see, you see, Lugano, the yellow line is the line of railroad. The Raetian ethnic group still speaks an ancient dialect relative to the Etruscan language. Thus, the promotion of the railway in correlation with the specific cultural landscape refers not to touristic and economic targets solely, but to a cultural and political scope as well. Next research proposal. Describing a palimpsest of superimposed layers of important places of different historic periods, as well as of natural landscape itineraries in Arcadia, in correlation to networks of important natural landscape references. Important landscape references, natural landscape references. We have described in maps superimposed layers of the qualities of the cultural landscape of Arcadia, the description of the natural earth bas relief on the left, and dense natural plantation territories on the right. We have also described visiting itineraries connecting historic places of antiquity, upper left, and the Byzantine period, bottom left, as well as places of important formation of anonymous architects on the right. And finally, we have to refer to the intangible cultural references. Diotima of Mantinea in Arcadia, upper left, a central figure in Plato's Symposium, indicated as having lived circa five centuries before Christ. Her ideas and doctrine of Eros, of love, as presented by Socrates in the dialogue of the Symposium, described the concept of Platonic love. Then, Goethe and Mephistopheles, the intangible present that Goethe offered to Arcadia, and Mephistopheles and Helen of Troy, as presented in the second volume of Faust, bottom left, and the great modern Greek poet Nikos Gatsos, born in Achaea, in Arcadia. I think that I have finished my presentation. Ευχαριστώ, as we say in Greek. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Professor. A wonderful presentation from mythology to our days. A wonderful journey. Thank you. We end the section.